Well, I must say, getting here today has been quite unusual. As you may or may not know, Pluto has now entered our wondrous orbit, bringing with it many geometric storms. These have completely and utterly messed up my fairy radar this tween time. I ended up levitating into the middle of a herd of cows, somewhere in the northern part of the Flat Mountains. Goodness knows how I got there. No, wasn't funny. They were very smelly. Now, let me just compose myself. Oh dear. Oh. Now, anyway, the main thing is I'm here now, and so are you. Now, I thought you'd want to come back and find out what happened to Thimble. We left her making a cake with Myrtle Milkwort. I also told you about Lady Blossomberry and how she was unfortunately banished. Now, I will tell you about her again later on, but for now, let us get back and see what's happening with our Thimble. Thimble had read scores of books about her clan, how they had lived in many realms under many different moons. She had seen old manuscripts of how different kings and queens had ruled, and of course about Lilibell and her mother's reign. Thimble thought she knew her clan very well indeed, and she would be very prepared if the queen were to test her knowledge of it. Find that highly unlikely though, don't you? She was feeling particularly confident, and her mood had somewhat lifted. Prunus had advised Thimble that she must first request a meeting with the queen formally, and that she should ask her father, Lord Flute, to take the request on her behalf, as all calls for counsel with the queen had to be delivered by a royal counsellor, old or new. So, Prunus and Thimble left the palace gates and made their way through the valley's houses and streets towards the apple orchard, where they were sure to find Lord Flute still procrastinating. And of course, there he was.
I do declare, it's Prunus, my old friend, exclaimed Lord Flute as he saw Thimble and Prunus approach. I do hope you've come to your senses now, Thimble. I dread to think what your mother will say otherwise, sighed Lord Flute as he stood up to greet the pair.
Seen sense indeed she has, my dear old friend, and just in the primrose nick of time. Till our no toil is no match for our lovely little Thimble here. We must do all we can in her quest to convince the Queen her decision is a deadly nightshade of one, said Prunus, shaking Lord Flute's hand and pulling out a parchment of paper from his topcoat pocket. Lord Flute slumped down by the apple tree again.
That's not exactly what I'd meant and precisely what I was afraid of. Oh well, so be it. Lady Flute will probably banish me for doing this, but I suppose you wish for me to take a letter to the Queen requesting her to meet with Thimble.
Prunus winked at Thimble and they both nodded. And with that, Lord Flute took the parchment paper from Prunus and began to write.
To Her Royal Highness Queen Lilibell the Red, on this day of the 30th moon in Saturn, I, Lord Flute, request that a meeting between you and my beloved daughter, Thimble Cotton Flute, take place as a matter of some urgency on a rather sensitive matter, seeking your approval. Please RSVP to me and I shall make the usual arrangements on calling council. Yours forever faithfully in your service, Lord Flute.
When Lord Flute had finished, he picked up his hat, fastened his cloak, and rolled the scroll of parchment inside it for safekeeping.
Now, When I return, Thimble, the Queen will expect you to fulfil your request to have counsel with her. There will be no going back. I hope you have prepared what you have to say well. Oh dear.
And with that, Lord Flute disappeared towards the palace. Gracioso nanito, said Thimble. Goodness me, which means fighting spirit and cake in the extremely ancient language of Travors. She's a very talented fairy indeed. I know. Anyway, speaking of cakes, Myrtle Milkwort in the meantime had far exceeded her own abilities of wondrous cake making and created a true masterpiece for Thimble to present to the Queen. This cake was truly the most amazing thing of beauty and sure to melt the heart of the confectionery-loving Queen. It was covered in strawberry icing which glistened underneath red and mauve chocolate roses. And if those weren't enough, in its centre, Myrtle had placed a chocolate fountain. Oh, brilliant. Anyway, now, will this be enough to convince the Queen, I hear you ask? We shall have to cross our fingers, hope, fill our hearts with fairy song, and read on. And so today, on the 30th moon in Saturn, Thimble will meet with Queen Lilybell the Red. And who knows what may lay ahead for her? As you may recall, there are some striking resemblances between Thimble and Lady Blossomberry. Both brilliant minds and an astonishing talent for magic. Both bound in some form to the confinements of pleasing their queen and family. And both with an extraordinary interest in the powers of levitation. However, let us sincerely hope that the similarities end there, as the fate that awaited Blossom does not bear thinking about for our little Thimble. Oh, what's the calling, birds? It can't be that time already. Well, I suppose I had such bother getting here. I do hope I levitate back okay. Really don't want to end up in that herd of cows again. No, I'm hurrying. Right, anyway, do take care. And next time we shall delve in further. I shall tell you a bit more about Lady Blossomberry. Now, until then, take care. And remember, don't stop believing. Especially in you.